Greetings. I got an interesting response to my video, a challenge to every Muslim on earth. Interesting because it serves as a perfect example of a very common strategy and tactic of Islam's dua and argumentation. I call it the jihad of avoidance. Whether Christian or Mohammedan, it takes intellectual honesty to directly deal with issues that are hurled at your belief system. Rarely does anyone from Islam ever deal directly with the many problems in the Quran. Instead, with Islam, they avoid them and counterattack. It is only natural. And this is exactly the strategy the Mohammedan takes with my challenge. Remember, the challenge is for any Muslim on earth to produce their proof that Jesus said the words claimed in Surah 61:6. Produce book and chapter and verse from the Injil where Jesus said this claimed prophecy about a man named Muhammad. Observe the jihad of avoidance at work. Your argument is plain dumb. Produce your proof if the fulfilled prophecy in Matthew 2:23 I posted on your other video. There's more like that. The fact that the author of Matthew misapplied an Old Testament verse is proof enough that the New Testament authors were willing to stray from the truth. I could be an extremist like you and say he lied, his book is a lie, and the Bible is a lie, but I won't. Then you want a Bible verses about Ahmad? You're not dealing with a full deck of cards. Let's look at it statement by statement. Your argument is plain dumb. The personal attack is absolutely commonplace when Mohammedans respond. And notice he does not continue and say why it is dumb or what is wrong with it. He is about to employ the jihad of avoidance and change the subject to a tit-for-tat counterattack. Produce your proof for the fulfilled prophecy in Matthew 2:23 I posted on your other video. Notice that he does not address the problem the video proves. He is changing subjects because he cannot face my challenge. There's more like that. This is a nice, unsupported generalization. And remember, never trust what a Mohammedan says the Bible says. The fact that the author of Matthew misapplied an Old Testament verse is proof enough that the New Testament authors were willing to stray from the truth. This is an interesting accusation. Let's take a closer look, shall we? The poster cherry-picks a particular prophecy, Matthew 2:23. But in Matthew chapters 1 and 2, this is only one of five such fulfilled prophecies. Cherry-picking, raping the context, dodging the issue. All elements of Mohammedism's intellectually bankrupt dawa for dimwads. Let's look at the five prophecies of Matthew 1 and 2. Matthew 1:21, and she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. Now all this was done that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, behold, a virgin shall be with child, and shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which being interpreted is God with us. And where does this come from? Isaiah 7:14. Therefore the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Notice the Mohammedan did not try to cherry-pick this fulfilled prophecy. Matthew 2:5. And they said unto him in Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet, and thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel. And where does that come from? Micah 5:2. But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from of old, from everlasting. Again, the Mohammedan did not dare to even address this fulfilled prophecy. He ignored it because it was totally fulfilled. Matthew 2:15, and was there until the death of Herod, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken of the Lord by the prophet, saying, out of Egypt have I called my son. And where does that come from? Hosea 11:1, when Israel was a child, then I loved him, and called my son out of Egypt. Try to keep in mind that Mohammedans don't have and can't know the Holy Spirit. They cannot help that the Bible is a closed book to them. At a purely face value, cursory reading of this verse, you might be tempted to think this talks about Israel, a person, the Son of God. But here is something you should keep in mind as well. After Jesus was raised from the dead, he did something very important. He taught the disciples from the Word of God all that had been foretold regarding him. That means the disciples knew all the places that God intended to convey that Jesus was the Son of God. Luke 24:25. Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory? And beginning at Moses, which was Deuteronomy 18, and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. You may bet your life that the disciples knew every prophecy in every text that was available to them, and Jesus made it crystal clear that these applied to him. So if Matthew applies Hosea 11:1 to Jesus, this is God's meaning that we should take away from it. So the poster's claim of misapplication is a claim out of ignorance, because he doesn't respect the Word of God, and is debatable at best and laughable at worst. Debate their meaning if you do not trust what Jesus said. But here is the key point you must not overlook. The words are there. The challenge is to find the words Mohammed claims are there. Mohammed's words are not there. And if you are counting, that is 3 out of 3 references proven accurate. Matthew 2:16. Then Herod, when he saw that he was mocked of the wise man, was exceeding wroth, and sent forth and slew all of the children that were in Bethlehem and in all the coasts thereof, from 2 years old and under, according to the time which he had diligently inquired of the wise men. Then was fulfilled that which was spoken by Jeremiah the prophet, saying, in Ramah was there a voice heard, lamentation when weeping, and great mourning, Rachel weeping for her children, and would not be comforted because they are not. Notice in this case, they not only have the prophecy, they name the prophet. And where does that come from? Jeremiah 31:15. Thus saith the Lord, a voice was heard in Ramah, lamentation and bitter weeping. Rachel, weeping for her children, refused to be comforted for her children, because they were not. Wow! 4 out of 4 references proven accurate. Prophecies fulfilled. And then we come to the only one the Mohammedan wanted to cherry-pick. Matthew 2:23. And he came and dwelt in a city called Nazareth, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophets, he shall be called a Nazarene. If you look in the King James or other Bibles, you will not find it. But don't buy the Mohammedan bend-over poop yet. Think like adults about what this might mean. There are several possibilities that must be considered. 1. Matthew made this up. Remember, this whole issue is because I challenged every Mohammedan on earth to produce proof of where Sura 61:6 comes from. We know Sura 61:6 cannot be found because Jesus never said these words. Rather than face that, the Mohammedan who replied is dodging, trying to make the same claim against one verse in the Bible, one prophecy out of five, and the other four are perfectly fulfilled. I, on the other hand, am more than willing to call Mohammed a bold-faced liar until any Mohammedan on earth can produce book and chapter and verse. Option 2. The verse is lost forever. Uh-oh! The Mohammedan will think this means this proves the Bible is corrupt. But they will be forgetting, number 1, a doctrine from the Quran, which says, Allah does not cause any surah or ayat to be forgotten except He replaces it with something equal or better. And there will be Mohammedans who dance like monkeys thinking this proves something they want to believe, that the Bible is corrupt. But even that is not really a problem. Losing a single phrase in this context only means that one of five prophecies cannot be confirmed. It does not prove the prophetic reference false. It means it cannot be proven as true. And being perfectly even, this is the core problem the challenge to every Muslim reveals. Muhammad's words cannot be proven true. But thank God we have four other perfectly fulfilled prophecies to establish the truth of the Word of God. Option 3. The verse is not lost, but is not in the Bible, not in the canonical text. This is the one that will really curl the Mohammedan's hair. How could Matthew refer to a prophecy that was a real prophecy from God, but wasn't somehow included in the Bible? It is possible that the reference is to a lesser prophet not included in the canonical Bible. It is also possible the phrase was lost somewhere along the way. And again, because we have four other perfectly fulfilled prophecies, one is not critical. But poor Mohammed, you see, has no credentials unless his one reference is fulfilled. Oh, Muslim, think what that means, that Mohammed has no credentials. There is not even one prophecy to confirm Mohammed. But regarding this fifth prophecy for which we cannot find the text, I did some digging on the internet, and I found an interesting website that mentions this about the Dead Sea Scrolls. But scholars who have studied the scrolls say a previously unknown line of text found in a Qumran version of 1 Samuel contains language that is startlingly close to Matthew's. It appears at the end of 1 Samuel 1:22, where Hannah, mother of the prophet Samuel, vows to take her newborn son to the temple at Shiloh, that he may appear in the presence of the Lord and remain there forever. The Qumran fragment adds a final clause that does not appear in the traditional text. And I will make him a Nazir forever. Personally, I am all about honest, transparent truth. And we know that the first four are proven accurate, while the fifth remains unproven, but not proven false. And we have this other reference from the Dead Sea Scrolls, which means it could have been in 1 Samuel. So we have a very plausible explanation with evidence to confirm that the verse was preserved in the Dead Sea Scrolls. Still, the Mohammedans will not grasp that the verse then was not lost, but was preserved in the Dead Sea Scrolls. I have no trouble accepting that all five out of five verses now have defensible sources. Returning to the Mohammedan's post, I could be an extremist like you and say he lied, his book is a lie, and the Bible is a lie, but I won't. Phew! He's letting me off the hook. I, on the other hand, am confident in saying Mohammed lied. His words are false, and you will never find a Dead Sea Scroll fragment to back you up, my friend. Never will Sura 61:6 have an atom of evidence to support it. Then you want a Bible verses about Ahmad? And you can now see the real reason to be so generous as to let me off the hook. He will forget the gross flaws in the Bible if I ignore the gross lie committed by Muhammad. You're not dealing with a full deck of cards. One last cheap shot, personal insult to seal the deal with an intimidating tone. Christians, do not let Satan seduce you into Islam. Islam is evil from the pit of hell, from the word go. There are millions of nice people. There are millions of sincere people going to hell convinced they follow Yahweh, but following Allah or Satan. Christians, pray for those who call themselves Muslim. All arguing aside, we Christians were dead in our own sins when Jesus called us. We were not called because of our own goodness, but His goodness. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And may God give you a sincere desire in your heart, a love for Muslim people, honest Muslim people who have been sorely deceived. They want the truth. Share the truth with them in love, and may God open their hearts and cause the seed to grow in Jesus' name. Amen.